Good day, Grade 12s, and welcome back. Our lesson for today is the discursive essay. In this series, we have already concluded the narrative essay, the descriptive essay, the reflective essay, and the argumentative essay. There are a number of overlaps between the argumentative essay and the discursive essay, which we will clarify as the lesson proceeds. So what is the discursive essay? Well, the discursive essay is a balanced discussion of a controversial topic. The word discursive is an adjective which means lengthy or broad, and so the discursive essay is a lengthy or broad discussion on a specific topic. Now, whereas in the argumentative essay, you only chose one particular side to defend, in this essay, you must actually present both aspects or sides of the argument. So this essay is not persuasive in nature, and just like in the argumentative essay, you also need to base your information on evidence, research, rather than on hearsay and assumptions. So it is very much an objective essay which prevents both sides of a particular controversial topic. When you plan your essay, then you must clearly indicate both sides of the thesis statement or argument. Remember, at this stage of the introduction, you are not really taking a particular stance. You are merely making a thesis statement, introducing the reader to the issue that is going to be discussed. So how do you do this? Obviously, you have to hook your reader, as well as introduce the topic in approximately one sentence. In this case, you basically have to present the dilemma, namely the two opposing views. And remember that this statement is going to form the core or the foundation of the discussion which you are going to have in the rest of your essay. Remember, whatever statements you make in the introduction should be expanded on with facts and sources and not merely feelings in the rest of your essay. So let's look at the topic in front of you. How free should free speech be? Based on the topic, we know that the thesis or theme or issue that will be discussed is the issue of freedom of speech and the implications of freedom of speech. So that then is the thesis or issue that you are going to discuss in your essay. So in your introduction, remember, you are going to make a thesis statement. You are basically going to inform your reader what the issues are or issue is that will be discussed in the essay. You will also clearly indicate that you are going to present both aspects of the topic. Freedom of speech is an ideal which is an intrinsic component of all democratic institutions because it encourages transparency and gives a voice to the majority. However, this freedom does come with certain responsibilities, which if not adhered to, can be detrimental to society. What do we have in front of us? We have our thesis statement, which clearly shows that the writer is going to focus on the positive aspects of freedom of speech, as well as look at the negative aspects of freedom of speech. This is just a reminder that, remember, you need to do your planning first, and so you will clearly indicate what your thesis statement is going to be. And because you are basically looking at opposing arguments regarding the topic, you need to also indicate in your planning which paragraphs will include the pros or will be in support of the thesis statement, and which paragraphs will be written in opposition to the thesis statement. So let's say you're going to have four paragraphs in your body. You might dedicate two paragraphs which will be based on the discussion surrounding the support of the thesis statement, and then you will have another two paragraphs which will focus on opposing views to the previous statements. So very much, it's almost like presenting in a way a debate where we have both the proposition and the opposition presenting their points of view. We now come to the body, of course, and we commence with paragraph 2. And so how do we structure the body? We firstly, obviously, we start with a logical connector. Remember that logical connectors are like signposts that we need to use in our essay when we want to guide the reader to follow a certain pattern in our argument. So if you're starting with your argument, you can use words like firstly, at first, or to begin with. And as you proceed with your subsequent paragraphs, you would use words like, for example, in addition to, and furthermore, etc. Now, in the preceding lesson with the argumentative essay, we looked in detail at different logical connectors that you could possibly use. So remember, you are going to have two different arguments, and so your logical connectors need to indicate this. And as a result, you would probably use words like in contrast to indicate that this new paragraph that you are starting is going to present a contrasting argument to the one in the preceding paragraph. So now we come to our body, our second paragraph. What do you need to include in that paragraph? Obviously, as mentioned, once you started with your logical connector, your first sentence will state the first point in your argument. So you've indicated in your first sentence that freedom of speech is a necessity because of this particular reason. Your next step then is to do the following. You identify one fact, one detail, and or an example that will help you to explain or substantiate that point. As mentioned here, you will use approximately 3 sentences to pack that information into. Your final sentence of your particular paragraph then must relate to the first sentence, and you must explain or justify how that evidence that you presented reinforces the argument or statement that you started with at the beginning of this paragraph. So what then is the evidence that you are going to use in order to strengthen whatever perspective it is that you are arguing about? So you could use examples, the opinions of experts. Remember, if you use expert opinions, then it makes your information seem reliable as well as credible. Use little anecdotes. These are short little personal stories which demonstrate to the reader what the issue is. And you know, it makes it quite relatable because it's somebody experiencing the problem or issue that is being discussed. Your own observations, of course. You can use precedent. That means that, you know, if something has been recorded of such and such an event at a previous time, if there was an historical event which is similar to the issue that you are discussing in your essay, then you can also refer to that. So in a nutshell then, that is the kind of evidence that you are going to use to justify or reinforce your opinions. Remember, it is not merely based on opinion, but it is an objective account, and you clearly have to show that you have conducted the necessary research, and you will obviously also use statistics if necessary to further substantiate your opinions or arguments. Below then is an example of how you would probably plan the body of your essay. So on the screen in front of you, you have 2 paragraphs which have been juxtaposed next to each other. And the reason for that is so that you can clearly see how your paragraphs should be constructed and the kind of information that you can include. So in paragraph 2, the writer will focus on the positive or supportive comment about freedom of speech. And then in paragraph 3, the writer is going to state an opposing point about freedom of speech. So you can clearly see, you can obviously decide, are you going to state a something in support of the proposition in paragraph 2, and then in paragraph 3 you're going to also do the same, and in paragraphs 3 and 4 you are going to basically state the arguments which support the opposition. So you can decide how you are actually going to structure your essay. Or alternatively, you can also do it as we have it on the screen, where paragraph 2 focuses on the positive aspects in support of freedom of speech, and paragraph 3 focuses on the oppositional argument of how freedom of speech can be damaging. So the first point with which you will start your introduction in that paragraph is, for example, freedom of speech is powerful. In paragraph 3, you will state freedom of speech can be damaging. So what is the evidence and that you, on which you're going to base your argument? Let's look at the screen in front of us. For paragraph 2, we are going to mention things like the oppressive regime during the apartheid era was toppled because of freedom of speech. But we also know that without the ability to criticize a government, the masses lose the ability to protect a democracy and also root out corruption. And here you can cite many examples. You know, it is very important that people be given a voice so that they can be heard. And so in a democracy, whether that voice is a critical voice, it is still important to be heard. Also, the writer makes the statement that it creates positive political change. So we can see that the writer has clearly presented an argument with evidence that freedom of speech is a desire. It is something which is a fundamental pillar in democratic societies. If we look at paragraph 3, the opposing point of view, we are now going to examine why freedom of speech can also be quite damaging. So in the first bullet there, the writer states it creates prejudice and divisions, and because people can also stir up antagonistic emotions. And now you can cite examples, and there are quite a lot of examples about events which have run their course during the our most recent, or during our present era. It does not necessarily have to refer to events 30 or 40 years prior to our discussion at this particular moment, but we can also look at how current events reflect what you are stating. Remember that people can also make false allegations, and as happened even in our broadsheet newspapers and very reputable publications, you know, the false stories have been publicized and published, and as a result, people's reputations have been ruined. And unfortunately, once it's out there, even if it's on Facebook, it's very late, because even if you rescind the article, or even if you apologize, people have already seen it, and ultimately then people have probably made up their minds about the issue already. We now come to the conclusion of the discursive or expository essay. And so in your conclusion, here at least, as a writer, if you have a very strong opinion about the side of the argument that you wish to take, then here you can clearly state what side it is that you choose. So how then, what then is your real opinion? So you can decide that you can either stand with the or support the opposition or the proposition. Or you can decide that you actually find yourself agreeing with aspects of both as a part of the argument. And so you can say, well, you agree and you disagree, and you very briefly state how you feel about it and which aspects of the issue you kind of agree with. Remember, in the preceding paragraphs, you stated your information objectively. using a matter-of-fact tone, and then at the end you state your opinion. Remember that you also want your reader eventually to decide for themselves which side of the argument it is that they support. Here is an example of the kind of conclusion that has or was referred to in the preceding slide. In conclusion, note there the logical connector, which clearly states that we have now reached the final paragraph in the essay. Every person needs to be cognizant of the fact that with freedom of speech comes immense responsibility. One individual's right to freedom of speech should not be allowed to impinge on another individual's right to freedom from discrimination. By being careful and constructive, we can help our own society become more stable and orderly. If words can be weapons, there should be restrictions regarding how they are used. So clearly the writer has integrated both the proposition and the opposition arguments of the topic or thesis statement. Note that the writer also uses a metaphor at the end of this essay in the concluding sentence to clearly state the devastating impact that words can have. And so this emphatic or forceful statement is used to close the essay and then also to close, in a sense, the writer's argument or opinion on that matter. If words can be weapons, there should be restrictions regarding how they are used. So let us just recap very quickly what the discursive essay is. It is a lengthy discussion on a controversial topic. You need to back it up with research, evidence, statistics, examples, case studies if necessary. When you plan, you obviously link your introduction to your thesis statements. In other words, you link your introduction to your topic. Then you have to plan your body. Your body should include of ideally 4 paragraphs. You, for example, can use 2 paragraphs to state an argument in support of the statement that has been made. And then you will have 2 paragraphs in opposition to or against the statement that has been made in the topic. Then you conclude your essay with your final paragraph, which will then also indicate what stance it is that the writer takes. So the writer can either be in support of, in opposition of the thesis statement, or the writer can support and to show support both aspects of the thesis statement or argument. That then brings us to the conclusion of our lessons on various essay types. As mentioned in the other lessons, please make sure that you find for yourself a niche. What kind of essay is it that you enjoy writing and that you are skilled at writing? Because remember, at this point, you are basically looking at amassing marks so that you can improve the mark that you have for English in general. Good luck. Enjoy your creative spirits.